smudges.
Woo! Look at this.
Oh, this is cute.
Hi.
No, I would accept this.
Legs.
That's it. There you go. Spark it along, guys. Okay, good. Here we go. This is fun. Now you got to look here now.
Yes,
we'll take several shots.
No. This is. You need to be able to bend this here like that.
This is cute, guys. Put your flowers up on your knee. Come on, kids. This is everybody squeeze a little bit closer. That's it. This is good. This is it. I love it. Right here. Everybody squeeze some more now. Come on, fat boy. Come on, Zoe. There we go, guys. I love it right here. Hey! One more. I'm moving the camera.
Zoe. Look up here.
No, up here. Hey! Gotcha. No. Super job. Here we go. Come on, big guy. Zoe, right up here dancing.
Thank you.
recognizing that it was in God's great love that he instituted this beautiful thing we call marriage. So let us come before him now and express our thanks. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful, so very thankful, that you have brought both Nick and Aaron together. And we thank you for allowing us to be here to witness and enjoy this celebration. It is important to them and to us that you come and be the guest of highest honor. Something new is about to happen as Nick and Aaron leave a life as two individuals and become one. We're asking that you, God, would come into that union and make it strong and lasting and forever yours. It's because of Jesus and his loving sacrifice that we ask this. Amen. You may be seated. Who gives this woman to be married to this man? Nick, do you pledge your trust to Aaron in all love, honor, and respect, in all duty and service, in all faith and tenderness, in all openness and honesty, to live with her and cherish her according to the guidance of God in Christian marriage? Aaron, do you pledge your trust to Nick in all love, honor and respect, in all duty and service, in all faith and tenderness, in all openness and honesty, to live with him and cherish him according to the guidance of God in Christian marriage?
I do.
If I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love.
Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe ourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues, put on love, which binds us all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. Since as members of one body, we were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in us richly as we teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. and as we sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in our hearts to God. And whatever we do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
Well, weddings offer the perfect opportunity to dress your best. It's not unheard of for the wedding party to pay thousands of dollars to get everything looking just right, as it does here this evening. I would like to encourage the two of you to consider a different kind of outfit as you begin your marriage together. There is no bridal boutique. There is no tuxedo rental shop that has this line of clothing. Because what I'm going to talk about is not putting on types of clothing, but putting on virtues or character qualities. These are gifts from God that we may choose to put on through our relationship with him. Here's what the Apostle Paul describes in Colossians 3, as it was just read for us. As God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. I want you to enter God's wardrobe with me to see how to dress a marriage for success. To the families and guests who are here today, I invite you to come along as well. It's a very, very big wardrobe. But let me warn you in advance that putting on these virtues means that something about you as a person is going to change. It's like when you put on a tuxedo or a beautiful wedding dress. The mere putting them on makes you feel and act differently. It's kind of like the movie Mask with Jim Carrey. When he put on the mask, his whole demeanor, his whole behavior changed. Well, when you put on these character qualities or these virtues that are talked about in Colossians, there is a positive transformation that will take place in your lives and in your marriage. So let's get dressed. The verses begin with a virtue called compassion. I suppose that we might think of compassion as being a type of undergarment, because compassion is something that is close to our heart and affects the way we feel. Nick and Aaron, compassion is that inward sense of caring when the other person has a need. It's the spark that ignites the action. It's like the heart of the Good Samaritan, who used all of his means, his time, and his strength to help someone else who was in need. It's like the heart of Jesus that was touched deeply when he saw lost and hurting people. I would encourage both of you to choose compassion each day, the first part of the day, and to wear compassion all day long. A caring heart is the foundation for a successful marriage. Kindness is the next virtue that is mentioned. Kindness complements compassion. It's like that color accent in your outfit that brings out all the beauty of the other colors. If compassion emphasizes the tenderness of your heart, then kindness is that ability to express those feelings that you have on the inside. Nick, I would encourage you to take time regularly to tell Erin what you're feeling on the inside, to tell her of the love that's deep within. Tell her the ways that your heart is feeling and choose practical ways to express that love. Aaron, I would encourage you to do the same for Nick. It will keep your marriage alive and fresh and beautiful. Humility is next on the clothes hanger, and it's waiting for us to put on. Don't get dressed without humility. Humility is a very unique virtue. You wear it discreetly, but its appearance cannot be hidden. Humility is the rare quality of understanding who you really are, and that is, you are God's creation, and you are the object of his mercy. God made both of you, and he has shown his mercy to you in the life and death of Jesus. May you come to understand that it's only because of Jesus that you can be humble toward each other. Humility will keep your heart right with God, and it will keep your heart right with each other. I would encourage you to wear it like a beautiful cologne. Though it's invisible, it smells oh so good. Gentleness is the next one. Gentleness is the tender response when maybe your natural response is to respond either quickly or harshly to one another. If kindness is the outward expression of compassion, then gentleness is the outward expression of humility. These words from the Bible have helped me in my own marriage, and I believe they'll do the same for you in yours if you apply them. The Bible says, be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. This is the perfect lead-in to the next item in our wardrobe called patience. Patience is defined as prolonged restraint. It's the habit of learning to wait for God's timing and ways rather than our own. Trust me, irritation and aggravation will come into this blissful union, and you will need layers and layers of patience to make it through those irritations and aggravations. I like the words of Harry Emerson Fosdick when he says, the most extraordinary thing about oysters is this. Irritations get into his shell. He does not like them, but when he cannot get rid of them, he uses the irritation to do the loveliest thing an oyster ever has a chance to do. He makes a pearl. If irritations come into this marriage, and they will, there is only one prescription: make a pearl. It may be just a pearl of patience, but anyhow, make a pearl. I pray that both of you will make many, many pearls in your life together. Be patient with each other. Finally, the last article of clothing in the virtue wardrobe is love. It is the prince of all virtues, and like a belt, it holds all the other virtues in its place. Love summarizes all that the Apostle Paul has mentioned in just one simple word. Again, reading 1 Corinthians, and it's probably read in more weddings than any other passage of Scripture. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, and it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Nick and Eric, it is our prayer for you that your marriage would be so wonderfully dressed and so wonderfully adorned. Now, if you would turn towards each other, take one another's hands, and get ready to exchange your vows to each other. And Nick, I'll start with you. I, Nick, take you, Aaron. To be my wife.
To be my wife.
I promise before God. And our families and friends. These things. To care for you. As God has called a man. To care for his wife. To love, honor, and serve you. To always be there.
When you need me.
To know when to speak. And when to listen. When to lead. And when to follow. I will be sensitive to your needs. Sharing in openness. And honesty. And seek with you. God's will for our lives. As we follow him together. For richer or poor. In good times and bad. In sickness and in health. This is my solemn vow. Okay. I, Aaron, take you, Nick. To be my husband. I promise before God. And our families and friends. These things. To care for you.
As God has called a woman. As God has called a woman.
To care for her husband.
To care for her husband.
To love, honor, and serve you.
To love, honor, and serve you.
To always be there.
To always be there.
When you need me.
When you need me.
To know when to speak.
To know when to speak.
And when to listen.
And when to listen.
When to lead.
When to lead.
And when to follow.
And when to follow.
I will be sensitive to your needs.
I will be sensitive to your needs.
Sharing in openness.
Sharing in openness.
And honesty.
And honesty.
And seek with you.
And seek with you.
God's will for our lives.
God's will for our lives.
As we follow him together.
As we follow him together.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In good times and bad.
In good times and bad.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
This is my solemn vow.
This is my solemn vow.
May I have the rings, please? In the spirit of this love, you will be exchanging rings with each other. Rings are the outward, visible sign of the invisible commitment that you are making to God and to each other. As you exchange these rings, I want you to be aware of how they portray the ideal marriage. The circle of the rings, with no beginning and no end, represents the wholeness and sense of eternity that will be present in this marriage. The gold, the purest of all nature's metals, signifies the purity that you want to maintain in this relationship. Nick, I'll ask you to take Erin's ring first, please. Place it on the third finger of her left hand and repeat after me. This ring I give to you.
This ring I give to you.
As a promise of keeping my vows.
As a promise of keeping my vows.
And loving you today.
And loving you today.
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
And as long as we shall live.
And as long as we both shall live.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
The Son.
The Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Erin, if you will take Nick's ring. Place it on the third finger of Nick's left hand and repeat after me as well. This ring I give to you.
This ring I give to you.
As a promise of keeping my vows.
As a promise of keeping my vows.
And loving you today.
And loving you today.
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
And as long as we shall live.
And as long as we shall live.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
The Son.
The Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Two separate lights that are behind me and in front of you represent your lives up until this moment. In the beginning of the service, I noted that something new was about to take place today. Two people would become one in marriage. The lighting of the center candle in front of you is designed to symbolize that reality. As you each take one of the outside candles and light the center one, I'll ask you to extinguish the candle that you're holding. Enjoy the music and these moments as you celebrate the beginning of that unity. Father, we ask that your blessings would come upon this couple as they build their life together. May it be a life of mutual respect, encouraging each other to be the best they can be for your sake. May they be fully clothed in the virtues that come from you. And now may your grace and mercy and peace rest on them. and on each of us, both now and into our future. And I would encourage you to join me as I recite the Lord's Prayer, and you're welcome to join me as I read. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would ask for the friends and families and all the guests of Nick and Aaron to please stand at this time. By the authority vested in me as a minister of the gospel of Jesus, and in accordance with the vows you have taken toward each other, and by virtue of the laws of the state of Ohio, I joyfully pronounce you husband and wife. Nick, you may kiss your new bride. It is now my pleasure to be the first to present to you Mr. and Mrs. Nick Czerny.
Okay, I'm going to On three. One, two, three. Get a shot up there. You get it? Zoom in, big guy. Climb up there with that tree and get it.
Money to pay for a DJ.
We're going to start with the parents of the bride, ladies and gentlemen. Janet Brayton, escorted by Tom Brayton. Next come the parents of the groom, who's also the best man, Shirley Cherney, escorted by Nick Cherney Jr. Flower Girl and the Ring Bearer, Zoe Lawhorn, escorted by Zeb Lawhorn. Bride bridesmaid and groomsman, Adrian Whetstone, escorted by Randy Lawhorn. Bridesmaid and usher, Shannon Churney, also the sister of the groom, escorted by Jeff Biederman. The maid of honor and groomsman, Lindsay Bishop, escorted by brother of the bride, Ryan Brayton. And now, if I could have everybody stand, please. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honor to introduce to you our guests of honor, the bride and groom, Mr. and Mrs. Mick and Aaron Churney. Come on, let's hear it for them. But I was going to say, how'd you like to see the bride and groom give each other a big old-fashioned hug and kiss up here, huh? They can do it again. You can do it again if you want. Very nice. We've got a little bit more mingling time before dinner gets underway. We'll have that coming up shortly with the serving of salad. So everybody relax. We'll have dinner coming up shortly. Let's give him a round of applause, huh? Big day for him, too.
Just bear with me a minute. I can't remember too much, so here we go. I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight to share this with us. To me, it just seems like yesterday when we first seen our beautiful face of Aaron. As the nurse came around and handed it to me and Janet, and today she's just as beautiful as she was then.
Aww. Yes, she is.
But now we're proud to share her with Nick and his family, and to you, Aaron and Nick, happy marriages happen when we marry the one we love. And they blossom when we love the one we married. Oh, so thank you.
That's great.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. I'd like to have the best man and father of the groom, Nick, come on up now at this time.
First of all, I'd like to thank all the family and friends for coming this evening to help celebrate the wedding of my boy and his beautiful new bride. I want to welcome, you know, Tom and Janet and Aaron to the family and Ryan. It seems, you know, just like what Tom said yesterday, you know, I was in North Dakota in the Air Force when I was 20. And my wife was like in labor for 25 hours, and they brought Nick out, and she was pushing. His head was like this long. You know? I said, "Man, this ain't my kid, really." You know, but after a couple hours, they said, "Relax." You know, his head went back. Everything was cool. So, you know, I was a little bit happier with that. But you know, I got to watch him grow up and become a young man that he is today, and I'm very proud of him. And I'm very proud of his new bride. And I just want you to remember to respect the marriage, respect each other, and never leave a day that you're mad at each other, you know, because that's important. Anyway, congratulations, Nick. And, you know, hopefully you'll get married again in your 25th year, and we'll be here again. So congratulations.
Thank you, Nick. I'd like to have the sister of the groom, Shannon, come up now.
All right. Growing up is a stressful time, but with a brother like mine, it was harder than the norm. From the scar on my lip to daily tortures, you could say we weren't very fond of each other. Then things changed. I had graduated high school, Nick was away at college, and I started to miss him. Since then, not only have I admitted that he is my brother, but he has become one of my most important people in my life. Things changed again when Aaron came along, and I watched how they deeply fell in love. They couldn't get enough of each other. The way they looked at each other, I knew they were meant to be. I can't think of a day that went by that Nick didn't speak a sentence without his eyes, face, or voice screaming Aaron. She too always knew she was in love with him, even from the first day she saw him. She once told me that the moment she saw him at work, she turned to a friend and said, "I will marry him someday." Well, today is that day. I have watched them wait for this day with stars in their eyes and hope in their hearts. You make a great couple, and it touches my heart to know that you're promising your love for a lifetime. Not only am I happy for you, but I'm also happy for myself.
I'm shaking.
Because I get the joy of seeing my brother forever happy and the honor of gaining a sister. Welcome to the family, Aaron, and here is to today and the beginning of a lifetime together for you both. Congratulations to the lovely new couple.
Thank you, Shannon. And also the husband, Nick, wants to come up and have a word as well. At least I think he does. I hope I'm not catching him off guard.
I can't tell you how honored I am to look around this room and see all that's important to me here today for the biggest and most important day of my life. Come to think about it, I know I've been blessed. See, I've had the opportunity to have two great loves in my life. The first, of course, being my mother. It showed me the meaning of caring, kindness, and the comfort that I'd never be able to live without. She planted the seeds for what I truly value and look for in a woman today. But there's one thing that should be included in this list. A tradition, as minuscule as it may be, ever since I could remember, my mom's baked me a birthday cake each year. I've had the opportunity to blow out my candles. They have my birthday wish. Although when I was younger, they all were success, wealth, or something thereof. For most of my 20s, they've all been one and the same, to marry Aaron. Well, today is that day. And that brings me to my second great love. Aaron, my best friend, my soulmate, I thank you. See, without even realizing it, my every birthday wish today has come true. So I'd like everyone to stand up for the groom. Let's make a toast. Raise your glasses. May everyone find their Aaron, and may their every birthday wish come true. Thank you.
Stay right there.
Excuse me.
Let's give him a round of applause for being good sports, folks.